Tonight, our subject is the Zema. Bible begins really with the dream. The all plays into a profound sleep, and God plays a profound sleep upon man as he steps. Now, our singer says in the scripture, saying the appeal to God, not to man, but to God, to awaken from this sleep. Awake, O sleeper, and rise from the dead. Rouse thyself, O God. Why sleepest thou? And throughout all the entire book, it's an appeal to God, who imposed upon himself this sleep. Now science, they speculate, and they get all kinds of theories in the world concerning a dream. But I have never read well any scientist ever succeeded in impaling a dream upon a theory. They can't take it and really impale it and analyze it to my satisfaction. But tonight we'll take these dreams for you and show you what we really are here in this fabulous world of ours. This dream is a dream within a dream. The whole vast world of ours is not a dream, and it's a dream within a dream. This morning at 4:15, I woke. I didn't want to get up at 4:15. So I said to myself, I will go back to sleep. But before I returned to that state of sleep, I communed with self and requested that I would be favored with an experience. A dream, or an ecstasy. Not something that I've never had before, something different. Something that had great significance and was very informative. And so, I fell off into the deep, once more interesting. And then I woke at 6:15, 2 hours later. And this is the experience that came back with me. I found myself in the apartment house where we as a little family of three lived for 13 years and 8 months, 145 West 55th Street. The same superintendent was there. His name was Amy Fox. When I lived there, the side of the family, he had operated. The elevator was operated by individuals. But now, it was a push-button affair. And I started from the ground floor into, and the man started before me, and Eddie Fox said, "Let Mr. Goddard," he called me Goddard. He said, "Let Mr. Goddard get in first." So I got him, and then two men got in with me. And then Eddie said to me, "What floor, Mr. Goddard?" And I said, "Six." But I didn't live on the sixth floor before. I occupied the penthouse. I had a duplex. And we were on the 15th and 16th floors before. We had the 13th floor, which was our living quarters. Then we had this lovely upstairs, the 16th floor, sort of a playroom and a lovely garden. And there we were for these many years, 13 odd years. So I got into the elevator, and it ascended, and I got up on the sixth floor. And then I realized, well, this is not where I live. I don't live here. And the two men got off on the same floor. And I said, you know, this is the strangest thing. This has never happened to me before. I never suffered from amnesia. But right now, I do not know where I live. can't remember where I lived. And they could not help me at all. And there I stood in this little hallway. The elevator's gone beyond. And I'm trying to remember, where do I live? I know I don't live here. And then I said to myself, you know, this may be a dream. And if it is a dream, there's somewhere in this fabulous universe where I am asleep. Or if it is a dream, I am dreaming this, and I must be somewhere sleeping, dreaming this. And if I am dreaming this, well then, the chances are I am lying down and sound asleep, dreaming this now. At that moment, I try to remember where could I be asleep. It wouldn't come back, and a thing would come back. And then I felt the feeling of being horizontal and sleeping. And I felt that motion. I'm horizontal and sleeping. I found myself on a bed. I deliberately would not open my eyes. I wouldn't open my eyes. I wanted to find exactly where am I. I couldn't. I thought, where am I? I would not allow myself to open my eyes on a familiar object on a wall that would relate me to a certain position in place. I tried to remember, but I couldn't bring back, where am I? I couldn't. And then suddenly, out of the nowhere, the little word Carol came into my mind. Carol's eyes. 10:25. At that moment, I didn't hear the voice, but from the depths of my soul, that being which is my own inner being, my deep being, that is dreaming this, without the use of words, it said to me, you asked for it. I heard it without hearing words. You asked for it. Because I requested before I dropped into the deep, having awakened at 4:15, and decided not to get up, but to go back to sleep. I asked for an experience that would be significant. Something that would be informative. Something that would be great that I would talk about and tell the whole vast world the great secret of creation. And then what happened to me? Well, what is the story behind it all? Here is a dream within a dream. Is this but a dream? I say it is. It is a dream. This whole vast world is a dream. And when I read the story in Scripture, and when he's about to awaken into this world, it comes in the form of a dream. And the angel of the Lord appeared unto Joseph in a dream and told him of the birth of the Savior of the world. And then when the very end of the story, we are told that when Pilate sat upon his throne, his judgment seat, that his wife sent a messenger saying, have nothing to do with that righteous man. For I have been greatly troubled this day in a dream because of him. So the whole thing was to dream. Now, can I dream into being by the depth of my own being, dream the kind of a world that I want? I can. That's the story. He tells it all, and he is not diverted from his dream. I am his emanation. I am his bride. Until the dream is at an end. He becomes one with his emanation at the very end of the dream. As tells us in Scripture. He leaves all and cleaves to his wife until they become one person. But I am his emanation, his wife, until this wonderful sleep is over. Until it's over, I think the 12 is projection, revelation. And here's this thing called men. But how can I, in some way, take the same technique and dream in my world of Caesar, as he has determined to dream me into his own being and become one with him? I recall that in 1948, my father heard me for the first time. I started lecturing in 1938. Then the war broke, he couldn't come to America. And in 1948, he came to America. And he heard me for the first time. And after that lecture that morning, we all came home to have brunch. And he said, "You know, my son, everything you said this morning, I'm living with it, all but one. You told the people to close their eyes when they meditate, when they begin to assume and to visualize objectives. Don't close the eye completely. If you close the eye exactly, that changes to a night dream. And this is a daydream. The daydream, you must have the eye ajar, but not shut. Just partly closed. But I could not deny my father's suggestion, not because he was my father, but here was a man who started behind the eight ball in life. No education, no social background, no intellectual background, but nothing, I mean, behind the eight ball in the true sense of the word. And when he died at the age of 85, he could leave a fortune to his 10 children. He raised 10 children. I never once inherited one nickel from anyone until at the end of his 85 years, leave to his 10 children a considerable fortune, running into multiple millions. And every day my father would sit in the silence with his eyes partly shut. And he would look and see what he wanted to do. He was controlled by not closing the eye. As he said, if you close the eye, you're drifting right into an night dream, where your attention is not controlled by you, it controls you. And you go right into an night dream. If you just close the eye, you can see what you want to see. And the whole thing comes to pass in this world. Everything as you see it. So tell your people the next time not to close the eye, but to simply bring it into a partial closing state, a jar. And bring before your mind's eye while the eye is not completely shut, exactly what you want to see. Carry on all the conversations that would incite the fulfillment of your desire. And do it in that way. And here was a man who was talking to me, who died at the age of 85, but long before he died, he had made his fortune. And I don't really believe my father ever did the dishonest thing in this world. I really do not believe he ever did. I really believe, it's my deep conviction about my father. Why, I don't know, but I think all of us, the 10 of us, feel this way about him. He met my mother when she was about 3 years old and he was about 8. It was a romance, the matter of 8 and 3. And then, when she was 18, and they got married, and he said to my little niece, "So we did a fabulous party for you today. Champagne is flowing like a river. Everything. When I married your grandmother, I could still afford a half pint of rum. And so we had a half pint of rum to celebrate the union, this wonderful wedding." But he went on with this simply partly closing the eye and controlling his attention and seeing what he wanted to see. And he called it the daydream. The daydream does not differ from the night dream. Saying that in the daydream you are in control, or you ought to be in control. In the night dream, it takes over. Unless you persuade yourself before you sleep to fade in with a dream that will be informative. And then you will do it. But if you don't, and you sleep after all the distress of the day, all the headlines of the day, all the newspapers of the day, and all the radio and TV bulletins of the day, that's what you get in the course of the night. That's confusion. That's a nightmare. But if you do it in this way, and he shows exactly how he actually went about making his fortune in this world. Why say the Bible has only one source of dreams in this world? All dreams, all visions spring from God. There is no other source of a dream in Scripture. And if there be a prophet among you, I the Lord will speak unto him in a dream. I made myself known unto him in a vision. And throughout the entire Scripture is all God speaking. But who spoke to me this morning? The text of my own soul. And it seemed at that very moment he was trying to entice me into a discovery of himself. For when I felt, I didn't hear a word, but I felt, you asked for it. I distinctly asked for an experience that would be unlike what I ever had before. But it had to be instructive, informative. Something that I could share with the whole vast world, and that they would actually understand the great secret of creation. And the whole thing came in this peculiar manner. Here I am, I didn't know where. I had forgotten where I laid myself down to do. Everyone has forgotten where he has laid himself down to be. Because the thing that you really are, that is in a profound thing, is God himself. You laid yourself down to dream. And you are dreaming what you are now. But this projected you can also dream, for the whole thing began as a dream and the end is a dream. So while we are here, if I could only catch it and know how to dream here, as the depth of my soul has dressed me into dream and has continued to dream, for myself as I have planned it, so shall it be. As I have purposed it, so shall it stand. No power in the world can stop my predetermined dream. It's a dream. What is a predetermined dream? That I shall wait my emanation. He fell in love with me. He fell in love with you. And you are unique. No one in this world can take your place. There is no power in the world that can modify you. In the eyes of the one who's dreaming. You modify the dream out here in the world of people. But no one can fill your place. You are unique. And when you find the dreamer, he is actually enticing you moment after moment to find him. And the moment you find him, the being that really has led you into being, you awaken and you will heal. So this whole vast world is but a dream. So when the poet asks the question, is all that we see or speak but a dream within a dream? And then in the same point, this is Edgar Allan Poe. He answers it. Instead of asking the question, he affirms it. All that we see or see. Is but a dream within a dream. Now, this is a great revelation of the name of God, and we word it in the same way that Paul did. I am that I am. That's affirmative. Am I that? Am I? use the word that as the dreamer. Am I the dreamer? Am I? And then come back. Change your feminine. I am. You mean I brought this whole that world into being? Yes, I did. I wish I could share it in the most intimate way with you that I experienced it this morning. No desire to get up for the scene. Only using the self. Give me a strength. Bring it forth to the form of a dream or an ecstasy. Either one. To me, ecstasy is vision. Very frankly, but more clear than this. So everything is finally real, just like this. Bring it either in dream or bring it like this. But make it informative. Make it something that is so significant that I can tell it to the world and show it to show the secret behind it all. And then that same seed of assessment at the very end, to ask for it. You can almost hear the word coming through, but the one word. I have heard the word time and time again. But this morning, they were not words, it was simply a mood of perception, as though he was simply kidding me. Just playing with them. You asked for it, didn't you? I did. I asked for it. And here I am with complete amnesia. I didn't know where I was. And yet, a vivid picture, same apartment house, the same Eddie Fox, who was a super, the same building. And I got up at the sixth floor, which is significant. On the sixth day, he made man. Here on the sixth floor, I come. You're coming to the inn, Harold. Let us make man in our inn. I push that button. Here's the sixth, off of the sixth floor. And this is not where I belong. I don't belong here on the sixth floor. I belong with the dreamer who dreamed man. Into being. Not with that which is dreamed into being, but the dreamer. That's where I belong. I couldn't find my place on the sixth floor. There was no room there for me. Something seemed right. And I couldn't remember where I laid myself down to sleep. But I did, somewhere, I laid myself down to sleep. And as I dreamed the dream. And I dream. I dream. And then my mind goes back to that experience that I think I've shared with many of you who are here tonight, some necessarily. But many years ago, I had this experience, which will be the 42nd song, if you understand the 42nd song. Where he makes great joy to the house of God. And this time in question, I found myself in this enormous crowd, a sea of humanity. And as I walked with them, and they're all in gay attire, oriental, God, very colorful. I heard a voice, and the voice screamed out, and God walked with me. And a woman to my right, a very attractive lady, in her late 30s, in all the Arabic costumes. And she questioned the voice, and she said, yes, God walked with us. Where is he? And the voice answered, at your side. And she turned to her neck. And looking into my face, he became to tell them, it's not a country that I could be the one thought of. And she questioned the voice, and she said, what is never God? And the voice answered, yes, in the act of waking. And then the same voice from the depths of my soul, this time audible only to me, but not to others. And the voice said, I laid myself down within you to sleep. And as I slept, I dream the dream. I dream, and I will be end of the sentence. I became so excited, I couldn't wait for the end. And at that moment, I felt these forces nail me to this body. My hands became forces, my feet forces, my head a vortex, and my right side a vortex. And then I am nailed to this thing. As the voice said, yes, in the act of waking. So here the same dreamer that formed, but he didn't see. First did he lay himself down to dream that he knew. He laid himself down to dream. That's where he laid himself down. He is within you dreaming that he knew. And when he awakes, you are me. The whole vast world is God dreaming that he knew. And when he completes the awake, you will die. And you will see the oneness of it all. Not one greater than the other. No one, you and I might have had horrible dreams. Some dreams of these mountainous states, and others dreams of wonderful pastures. Easy lives, but if you're all right, not one is better than the other. So the individual may have this most mountainous climb, and he thinks that's marvelous, but you're all right, that's your dream. And others will say, well, isn't it marvelous to hear green pastures? Or nice, wonderful sheep. And you dream of that. So it's entirely up to the dreamer. Just as he dreamed his wonderful one into being, he allows this wonderful one, as he puts him through all the great furnaces of affliction, to dream and comfort all these things in the world. So you could just start. Take the most glorious concept of yourself. I don't care what it is, believe me. My father never had a nickel, but he got a penny. And today the estate he is left, his 10, exceeds $25 million. And he didn't enter politics to get it, that, did he? Didn't come from politics. It didn't come from anything that is subversive. It just from his daily dream. He would sit in the silence, I can see him now, in what I call in Barbados, a Burmese chair. It comes from Demerara. It's a chair with elevated, extended arms. He put his feet out, and they were elevated. And then he would sit after breakfast, which was served for him about 10:30 in the morning. Well, that was what we call breakfast in the best people. The breaking of the fast, if my father was simply a cup of coffee early in the morning. Well, then what he called breakfast would be around 10:30, and that would be like another dinner. A good, substantial meal. And then he would sit quietly with the eyes constantly shut and see all the transactions of business of the day as he wanted them to be. Not as they could be if others interfered, as he wanted them to be. And day after day he did it with the eyes partly shut, that it may not plug into the night, that he could control it in the daydream. For he knew his Bible better than any minister in the island. It's the one book that he read. And he read it day after day after day. And he understood his Bible. He never read any other book. All the others were brilliant scholars, but they didn't understand the Bible. Any more than the brilliant ones today understand the Bible. By the time magazine came today, what is almost rather ridiculous. Read the religious page today. Here is this fantastic power in the world. And when you see what they own in Italy, all under the guise of being prophets of the Lord. But they are really prophets of the Lord, but not P-R-O-P-H-E-D. They are prophets quite differently. When they own 15% of all that is put on the stock market in that land, and confirm then that if you will attack us, we are the only tax exempt holders of this stock. All that are paying taxes, but we don't pay taxes. And if you threaten us to tax us, we will sell overnight and the market will crash. And they represent this great mystery. They have the slightest concept of the great mystery. So let me tell you how it comes to an end. It comes to an end in the simplest way. You can't accomplish it. Nothing you can do until you wait for the birth. It comes to an end in this manner. Suddenly, Jesus Christ awakens in you. Jesus Christ is born in you. Jesus Christ and you find God. Begotten Son, and calls you Father, and then you know who you are. Then Jesus Christ, in you, tears the temple in two, from top to bottom. And Jesus Christ, in you, as the Son of Man, ascends that spine of yours as a fiery serpent, and then the Holy Spirit in bodily form as a dove descends upon you and smothers you with affection because his work is done and you have come to the end of the dream. For you have been with us. And you only wait the lingering days until you take off this garment for the last time and find that you, who began the whole dream, you have awakened with an increased power. For there is no limit to expansion of God. There is no limit to the translucency of God. There is only a limit to the contraction of God, to the opacity of God. So man is that limit. Man is that contraction. And God become man, that man may become God. So then he span, and the end of his dream as man, which was predetermined, comes in these simple, simple pictures, four simple little events, all in man. So, stop this night and take my father's advice, who made the fortune. I don't think very many people in this world can be 25 million bucks. Your family is not a public company, it's a private company. And he could turn and give us this sort of money. And he himself not once did he ever get one nickel from another. And may I tell you, if you are not educated, he wasn't. By our standards, he would not have gone beyond a couple of grades in high school. A man who loved people, people loved him. A scrappy fellow of 6'2", 6'3", and just a generous, wonderful fellow who just loved. But day after day, 7 days a week, he practiced as though he was really a concert artist. He wouldn't let days go by because it was another day. He sat every day and did it. And the only criticism he had of me was, I told the people to close the eye. And he said, we had leaves only if you were nice. Don't close the eye. You don't close the eye. It's the daydream. And the daydream must be controlled. The night dream belongs to the depth of your soul. That's the deeper you, and it will take all the energy of the world and soul itself to educate your mind here. But on this level, don't close the eye. If you don't close the eye, you are in control. And then you can control the daydream. And this is the while he is bringing into being his predetermined picture, and no one can stop it. No one will work on the topic. Well, you read the papers and you read all these headlines that this country's going to take over, that country's going to take over, what should our president do? And everyone's so concerned, and they're all so wise. That's why I came home and just turned on TV and started lovely Cinderella. So here was Cinderella. Well, I was too lazy to get up and turn off the thing. And then came the great mentor, Mr. Littman. Well, I was too lazy to turn him off. But I sat and looked and listened to all of this wonderful, what we should do and what China could do, what they'll do. The things to do that they can, and the thing to do was God's dream. And yet, a brilliant mind. His choice of language, his choice of words, perfect. But my laziness allowed me to see this thing coming into me. But how many saw that, I don't know. Here was this considered, brilliant, brilliant mind, analyzing exactly what we as a country should do. And maybe his influence never seemed to write a lesson. He may be persuaded, I don't know. That's not what to do. Close your eyes just a little bit and see what you want to see. Don't hate anyone in this world. If you want to leave something behind you, leave it behind you, but don't just drop it out. Leave it behind you. Others will enjoy it. What I describe today, some of us enjoy it more. I have a lovely maid. I don't wear things out before I get them away because I don't want people to give me something worn out. And so, if something that a little broken seam, I would say, no, this is a broken seam on this shirt, you take it. And so my wife said to me tonight, you know, she'll catch on after a while and you make a little broken seam there. I said, no, she won't. Certainly all right. And so, you just don't wear a thing out and give it away. Some of them use it. So don't think for one more what others will do with it. What do you want to grow? Do you want to be wealthy? If you really want to be wealthy, you can be. Do you want to be healthy? To be known? I don't care what you want to be in this world. On this level, it's all within the framework of God's plan. Because you and he are one. In the depth of yourself, I heard the words distinctly. He laid himself down within you to sleep. And as he slept, he dreamed a dream. He didn't lay himself down up there to dream me. He is in me, dreaming me. So when I'm sitting in this New York City, or in my dream, standing in this little corridor, what in prayer? Am I dreaming? This current place where I must be sound asleep, dreaming this, but get into the dream, where am I dreaming? And I couldn't bring it back. I just couldn't remember where I fell asleep to dream this dream. But I must be asleep someplace. And then I felt myself on the bed. And then that wonderful, whimsical little feeling, you asked for it. But oh, what a revelation. And then comes the memory of that moment in time when I was seeing enormous crowd filled with this invisible, heavenly state. And the voice said to me, I laid myself trembling in sleep. And as I slept, I dreamed the dream, I dreamed, and I accept his dream in his sleep. And when I awake from this dream, I leave. Here I am. So this is the story. So tonight, take your glorious dream, wonderful dream, a little while dream. Let it fit that wonderful statement in the Sermon of the Mount. Do unto others as you would have them do unto you. Let it fit that. All right, there's a dream that's perfect. Let it fit that statement. Do unto others as you would have them do unto you. And if that fits it, but in dreaming, and see it clearly in your mind's eye and believe in the reality of this imaginal act, and it will come to pass. No power in the world can stop it. And they will come this fantastic experience in your life. But everything said of Jesus Christ, you will experience. I was coming home from a funeral about a year ago. A lady said to me, who drove the car, first of all, she said, you know, our plane's in the back, and it's a lovely, sweet Japanese house. And she said to me, they are Catholic. Well, I was certainly surprised, because of a sudden you think of Japanese as Buddhist. At least I did. And she said, they are Catholic. Then said she to me, our Christian science. That's all right. Then said she to me, what are you? And I'm a Christian. She said, well, I took that for granted, but I mean, what kind of Christian? Are you a Catholic or your Protestant? I said, no, I'm just a Christian. Well, that made no sense whatsoever to her. I'm a Christian. Well, you must be a Protestant of some kind, or you must be a Catholic of some kind. You're not a Christian scientist, I said, no. Are you a Jew? No. Religious science? No. None of these things whatsoever. I'm just a Christian. And then I thought, well, now, can she take it? And then I told her. I'm a Christian because Christ has been resurrected in me. He has been born in me. He has discovered the Son of God that is from in me. He has lifted himself up in me in seven times form. He split the tail of my body. And then the doubt descended upon me and smothered Jesus Christ in me with affection. That was the journey came to an end. And we want each other now. So whether she thinks me insane or not, I don't really know. But that is my story. I'm a Christian because I have experienced the Christian mystery, not because of the accident of birth. Father, everyone here, you will one day, I say to everyone, have the identical experience. Because there is only that story to be told in the world. There is no other story. They try to make it into all kinds of forms, because there is no other story. The story of God's salvation, how he emanated himself, fell in love with revelation, took himself to the dream world, which is a horrible state, and then completely yielded himself to his emanation, and then fused and they became one. And then God awoke. And he and his emanation, his pride, were one. Now let's go to the sound. My book, and the book she wrote, I recommend. every number in Scripture has a symbolical value. There are only 7 revelations, you'll find the 12 in Revelation, and 144,000 revelations, all kinds of numbers. Like my experience this morning with the 6. I got off of the 6 Lord. Simple little thing, why get out of the 6 Lord? The 6 Lord, and you have more than 6. But it was not yet a 6 Lord, it would be man. Well, 7 in Scripture is simply completion. On the 7th day, he rested. It's a mystical sense of a finished test. And the 8th is a new beginning. So the 7th is completion, that it comes to an end. But the 8th is the important one in Scripture. Because on the 8th day, he rose, which is the first of a new age. The 7 days, so the next day would be an 8th. And on that first day of the new week, he rose, this was the 8th. The beginning day, so there is no beginning or end to an 8th. Almost like the hourglass. There's no beginning or end, not the beginning of the end. The 7 is completion. The work is finished. And we rest it. Any other questions?
Yeah, but you have mentioned at one time or another using the expression woodland for this plane that was missing. Would this be equated with the dream of God?
Yes. This is woodland. This is the most important part of our concern. To be here in this world, to be born in the womb of woman, is the most important thing in the entire creation. To come through the womb of woman into this world. And those who have not entered this world, and they are unnumbered, they are punished wisely, that death is death. We don't believe it's death. We think this is the only living world. But to them, this they call it woodland, and this is simply eternal death. As Blake said, those in great eternity who contemplate on death, meaning this world, says that what seems to be is to those to whom it seems to be. And it is productive of the most dreadful consequences to those to whom it seems to be, even of torment and despair and eternal death. So in this world, what seems to be, just as we said earlier, that it really seems to be that I be self-persuaded, though we can deny it, that it is, all in this world of death. But divine mercy sets beyond and redeems man in the body of Jesus. So here this world is woodland. And you're told in the 8th chapter of the Book of Mormon. And when the eye was opened, he was asked, what do you see? Said, I see men like trees walking. I recall busy one night, I told the story in San Francisco, and it's just a strange reaction I've told it since. But I saw this politician, he's now gone from this world. He was one of the important members of the Socialist Party, a great opponent of church. A well, that was one. Well, that was his name. You might have read about him or heard about him. Well, in vision I saw it. And I saw him take this tree and put it on his head. Huge branch, all like a huge big stag. And he tried to jump off this cliff and float as it were. And he fell flat on his face. He got up, took this thing back on his head again, and made several attempts to really be this thing. And I knew that was not it. You can't put it from the outside. That's what he was trying to do with socialism in England. He was trying to do all of these things on the outside for man. You can't do it. It has to come from the inside. And so you do know these things if you ever saw them psychically. It's the most amazing sight. You look like the most fantastic stag, yet you're human. But they grow from within. The tree grows up. We are the tree of life. And nature, all the wise men of the world, as we're told, and all the gods of the earth and the sea, sought through nature to find this tree. But that touch was always there. There is not one in the human brain. Until it starts growing on the inside, it grows up. And when you see this majestic, flowering thing that grows from that, as Paul said, now, henceforth is laid upon me a crown of righteousness. For he said, the time when my departing has come, I have fought with fight, I have finished the race, I have kept the faith. Henceforth is laid upon me a crown of righteousness. Well, it grows from within. The tree turns out. After the body is split, all the energies of that now into generation are turned up into regeneration. And that wonderful thing grows from your head. And your majesty beyond the wildest dream of man. You don't put a crown on your head as a queen does, with all these artificial things that are dead. This crown grows from within. And you have a majesty beyond the wildest dream of the world. Growing out of you, you are the majestic being. And so everything grows out of this wonderful color man, where God entombed himself. So in this world, seen from above, before it starts to grow, and they can't see that, it has been off this age at all. They see all the state, and they call it wood man. So when the eye was open, what do you see? I see men as trees walking. But when we enter the new age, we enter the new age, just as you see the wonderful stag, when he first breaks forth, and the little things begin to appear on his head, they come from within. And they get bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger as he grows into this majestic creature. And it never stops growing. So the tree was felled, and everything was felled. And then the leaves were torn off, the limbs were severed, the branches were scattered, and no bird could find any rest and no shade for the animal. But you're told, do not disturb the roots. Let it grow, and let the dew of heaven water it. And the dew of heaven watered it, and then it began to grow. So God was the one that fell. That was the tree of life that fell. He fell in Eve. And so it came down into generation. And then my wonderful dream, there was a nightmare. And then comes the turning up of the energy that went into generation, into regeneration. And then, if you could see it practically, you would wonder, how did you get to this house? But it does no three-dimensional barrier to stop it. What you wear in glory, you bring into anything, but you couldn't, how could you possibly enter this room if the room could stop it? Good night.